this beautiful thing for us because he loved us. He did the hardest thing he could possibly do and allow himself to be separated from his Father God, which he had never experienced, for us because he loved us. He took on our pain, our sin, our suffering, our sickness, our disease, so that we could live an abundant life. Glory to God. He did that because he loved us. And so what other response can we have except to love others the way he first loved us? Glory to God. Jeremiah 31:3 says, "The Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee." God has always been in the business of bringing us in. He has always been in the business of making a path for us to fellowship with him. He doesn't want sin to separate us from his great love wherewith he has loved us. Bless the Lord. In Matthew 6, it says, "But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Where your treasure is. Now that word treasure, I like it, comes from a Greek word, thesaurus. We've heard of that one before, right? A thesaurus is a treasure of words. When we're looking for different words to describe something, like we need a different word to say good because we run out of natural words. And so we go to the thesaurus. That's a treasure of words. But it tells us here that that Greek word thesaurus means a repository, treasures, a treasure chest. And so where your treasure is, where your valuables are, where your storage is, glory to God, that's where your heart will be also. And that word heart comes from the word cardia, which means the seat of your passions. What is it that's driving you? What is it that's causing you to live this resurrection life? Amen. And so if our treasures are in fact in the Word of God, if that's where our heart is, if that's where we're putting our treasure in, then glory to God, we are better equipped to love others as God first loved us. The seat of our passions, hallelujah. Being able to love other people, being able to live the resurrection life that God has called us to. And 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new." And so on Resurrection Sunday, what the world calls Easter, in the olden days, we would make a big deal of making sure we had something new to wear. My girlfriend and I were just talking about how good it is to be free from that pressure of shopping and looking for something that you like that your kids will wear. And my daughters are teenagers now too. So it's kind of like that whole dressing them in the cute little frilly dresses where they couldn't fight me back. Those days are over. Now it's all like, okay, can we live with that? Okay, now that's too short. Okay, that, like, so we're not agreeing about what they should wear. But the idea where it came from, it wasn't designed, celebrating Resurrection Day with new clothes wasn't designed to add stress. It was designed to epitomize the fact that we have been made new, that we are in fact born again, that we are putting on these new fresh clothes that have never been worn again, which reminds us of our newness in Christ. We have been made new. And so those things that the world and the enemy keeps trying to pull us back in, we have been made new. Amen. And Jesus died, suffered on the cross, allowed himself to be separate from his Father so that we could be in fellowship with him. That's love. That's love. And Pastor said it exactly right. We don't need to wait for someone else to show love to us before we show love to them. And when we do things the way God's word says, we can only experience winning and victory. When you love someone and bless them and pray for those people who are mistreating you and despising you, when you are doing what the word says to pray for them, bless them, do good to them, You are overcoming that trap that's been set for you. You know, he was just talking about cartoons. You know, they have those manhole covers and, you know, you'll see the cartoons like make a big leap over the manhole cover so they don't fall in. You living the way God's word says is allowing you to avoid those traps, those pitfalls, those things that are designed to slow you down and to stop you. But what's so beautiful about it is, again, the way God will love you and draw you into him. The way he will just speak to you, not yelling, but with a soft voice because he loves you. I was reading in a study book. Now this is, and this, I'll just go ahead and tell you all the story of how it happened. I was in the mini house with Pastor on Friday for Good Friday service. And I was sitting there and I was preparing for service. And the Spirit of God drew my attention to this book on his bookshelf. It's a Tehillim, I believe is how you pronounce it. And it's a book of, it's got Psalms and Proverbs, but it's got the Hebrew and it's got a lot of commentary from the rabbis about what these Hebrew words mean. It just like brings the word to life in a different way. And years ago, I used one of those books to study Proverbs 31 because I wanted to be a Proverbs 31 woman. Yeah, because that's hard work. But anyway, what happened was I studied it, and it took me a long time to just go verse by verse because every word has a rich treasure. We just talked about that, right? The thesaurus. And so there was rich treasure. So I'm just taking my time. I wasn't in a rush. But as I was sitting there Friday, the Spirit of God showed me that and told me, I want you to study Psalm 112 in the Tehillim. Psalm 112, okay. And so I did that, and here's one of the nuggets that I found. There's, again, so many good ones. Psalm 112, stanza 1 says, praise God, praiseworthy is the man who fears Hashem. Hashem. And this is what it says. The righteous man fears Hashem in private as much as he appears to fear him in public, because his fear of God is genuine and sincere. He fears God exclusively and has no fear of mortal men. So you're not concerned about what man is going to do to you, what man is thinking about you, because your concern only is what God thinks of you. But I like this. And please forgive me, Rabbi, if I get your name wrong. Rabbi Eliezer Rokish of Worms notes that this man is not called the one who fears Elohim, the dispenser of strict justice. Rather, he is called one who fears Hashem. So Elohim is another name of God. But this verse talks about he is a man who fears Hashem, the dispenser of kindness. And I need you to write that down. The dispenser of kindness. This loops in directly with Jeremiah 31 and 3, that he is a God who is constantly drawing us to him. He is not drawing us to him so he can beat us down. He is drawing us to him with his loving kindness. Remember, Hashem means the dispenser of kindness. This teaches that the righteous man's fear of God is not derived from the knowledge that God can punish him, but from the realization that God loves him. In return, he loves God and greatly desires his commandments. This man has but one fear, that he may sin and destroy the intimate relationship which he enjoys with God. And to me, when I read that, it went off on the inside of me, because so many people are living this life in fear that God is out to get him and God get them. And God is only out to win you and to love you and to encourage you to walk out the life he designed for you, because he knows that is going to get you to your good and expected end. Hallelujah. And so in living this resurrection life and remembering who we are in Christ Jesus, we have a loving God who is going to do little things like whisper and like tell you to pick up that book or read this scripture or sing this song. And all of those things that God is whispering to you and loving you with is to bring you into a place of peace with him, so that you can be confident in who you are and you can go and love other people. Do what God called you to do. I want to close with this. The Bible tells us that every single one of us members of the body of Christ, we're supposed to do our part. And then when everyone is doing their part, we are fitly joined together by what every piece of the body supplies. And so when you're living your resurrection life, you are supplying your piece to the body. Now, we don't have any favorites in this church, but I'm gonna pick on Brother Reggie again. I know Pastor does it a lot. But Brother Reggie has started sending me, I know, me and Minister Barbara, but sends us songs, music in the mornings before we pray. And what that does is it allows us all to be listening to the same song. So when we come on that prayer line at 6 o'clock, we are on one accord. We are already in the flow of the Spirit. And see, I didn't have that idea. The Holy Spirit gave that idea to Brother Reggie. And Brother Reggie decided to love us enough to obey God. And he has set us on a trajectory to pray at another level. Praise God. But everybody doing their part. Everybody bringing their supply. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask, we're going to receive communion this morning. And so if you would get the communion elements and distribute those. That love, glory to God, that God loved us with. We are celebrating that today. So I don't care if you have on something new or something you have had for years. Our hearts have an opportunity.